Arriving home from the craziest day, and there's no meal that we think we'd want to make. The thought of leftovers makes my stomach feel sick. Need something good, but that something isn't quick. And you didn't want to cook at home, 'cause we didn't think anything was remotely appetizing. Now we're realizing that we probably should have made a plan, 'cause this week is halfway through, we know this budget's blown now. That's when we go and eat out. This restaurant's nice, but we spend too much on food. How in the world does it cost this much for two? But now if we plan for what's in store, we can save for so much more. And now we know it's cheaper cooking at our home. 'Cause if you like the way it tastes so much, then maybe we should budget more for food. But that's insane. Let's save up for a house, a car, and probably retirement too. And when we planned to have dinner with some friends, we had to choose to go out or eat in. But we know all our favorite restaurants aren't cheap. But I'm too tired to go buy groceries. And you didn't want to cook at home, 'cause we didn't think anything was remotely appetizing. Now we're realizing that we probably should have made a plan, 'cause this week is halfway through, we know this budget's blown now. That's when we go eat out. This restaurant's nice, but we spend too much on food. And how in the world does it cost this much for two? But now if we plan for what's in store, we can save for so much more. And now we know it's cheaper cooking at our home. 'Cause if you like the way it tastes so much, then maybe we should budget more for food. But that's insane. Let's save up for a lakefront cabin and possibly a schooner or two.
Or every time I go, happy in your aisles, I'm in my shopping zone. 'Cause you get me, you get me, you get me, e-e-e-e. Oh, Target, you're my love, you're my natural habitat. And can it be so bad if it's on the sale rack? I'm spending, I'm spending, I'm spending, e-e-e-e-ing. And it's long when I walked in, so shame on me now. I'll curse you, ever present dollar bins, 'cause you bring me down. Oh, I knew you were trouble when I walked in, so shame on me now. I knew the throw pillows would do me in. Oh, my marriage, this will be a battleground.
Hello, everybody, and welcome to our live on how to save more money. So before we get into it, I always want to make sure that everybody can hear us. So if you wouldn't mind hopping over in the comments and letting us know where you're listening from, that'll just let us know you can hear us for sure. And it's also just kind of fun to see where folks are from. So I see Giovanni loves the waiting music.
Isn't that awesome?
It is fun. We do usually get tapped for, you know, sometimes they think that we're playing the actual song. So we're like, no, it's a parody, guys. That's all right.
Think of how amazing those songs are going to be in like 10 years and how lame they're going to be in 5. You know, there's a weird stretch of time there where we the coolness level dips and then rises again.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah, they're getting a little dated. I think we need to do it again. Yeah, we got
all over.
Yeah, Dan in Houston. Oh, David in Denmark, all the way from Denmark. That's cool.
Ohio.
Merlin in Denver. Vancouver. Awesome.
Cool. Are you guys already using YNAB? How long have you been using YNAB for?
Let us know. Are you guys new people, or you've been using it for a while? Or maybe you have never even heard of YNAB and you just stumbled across this.
Yeah, what is YNAB?
Yeah, and we're brand new.
Right? YNAB? Is an app for wine?
No, it is not an app for wine, believe it or not, although that would be pretty awesome. But it is a budgeting software. That's what we're talking about today. So I'm Ben. I'm community manager here at YNAB and teacher. And this is Kelly.
Hi, everybody. I'm Kelly. I'm also a teacher here at YNAB. I live in northern Wisconsin. You may have attended one of our free 20-minute workshops with one of us in the past. But this is actually a little bit different. We thought we'd come out here to discuss with you guys different ways that you can save money and cut spending. I know that a lot of you are maybe working hard on that this month, right after the holidays, usually when we're most gung-ho to find some solutions for that, huh?
We thought it'd be a good time to talk about that. And I'm seeing lots of people have been using it for a while. I see it kind of running the gambit. Some people are new. Some people, Lane says 2.56 months, so very specific there. Yeah. 2 years. One person says since YNAB 4, so since it was a desktop only. So lots of folks have been with us for a long, long time. Since October. So yeah, cool.
What about you, Ben? How long have you used YNAB?
About 7 years, I think. I think it will be 7 years this year.
You got me beat.
No, it'll be 8 years this year, actually.
We just hit five years.
Nice.
Yeah.
Nice.
We were huge YNAB fans before we started working for YNAB. So
yeah. So dream come true there for sure.
Definitely.
All right, cool. Well, it looks like Heather's here from since YNAB 3, so she's got us beat.
Yeah.
You and Heather, good job. Cool. Well, thanks for joining us, everybody. So yeah, let's talk about ways to save more money. I think we'll start with just some general tips. So why don't you start on that, Kelly?
Yeah, sure. So I think when you're looking for ways to cut back, it's better to you want to be realistic, first of all. And it's better to look for the small wins rather than looking for those giant amounts right away. Like instead of looking for a place to cut back $100, you might consider just looking for 10 places to cut back $10, because that'll add up to the same thing without maybe as much restriction, or might feel like you have as much restriction there.
Yeah. And if you're using a budget, it's easy to do that, because you could go through and say well, I'm going to cut 10 bucks here or $5 here, and that can make a really big difference. And I think when you're thinking about this, it really helps if you just question all assumptions. That's kind of a motto around here. We say that a lot, where when you're thinking about your money, don't write off anything when you first start, because it's easy to be like, well, I can't control what this bill is, or something like that. Really look at every single bill and expense or area where you want to spend, and try to just ask yourself, is there anything I can do? Even if you feel like there's nothing you can do there, if you think about it for a little while, you might be able to make a change there.
And we'll go over some things that you can do to question those assumptions that you might not even know you are assuming right now. But starting with the easy wins is always a great place too. Big picture stuff that you can work on right now, whether it's something that's been nagging you, I really got to cancel that magazine subscription that I haven't used in 3 years, but continue to get charged. I actually did that this week.
Nice.
Yeah. So that's a quick, I got $16 back when I did that without even very little work. I just had to go to the website was basically the only thing.
Right. Yeah. Sometimes there's things that you'd be surprised. Yeah. I hear all sorts of stories of just really easy things. So, another thing is maybe try a spending freeze. So this is kind of a cool thing that a lot of people try, because you can do anything, well, almost anything for a short amount of time. Totally. Right. And so what a spending freeze is where you pick a very specific amount of time, maybe it's a week, maybe it's a month, maybe it's 2 months, whatever it is for you. And you decide, I'm not going to spend anything except for essentials, right? Or you can make your own rules, like say, I'm not going to eat out, or I'm not going to do this or something like that. And what it does, not only do you save some money, right, but you also kind of reset your thinking, your maybe some habits that you have about how you spend money. You'll start realizing that maybe, like, for example, maybe you eat out a lot and you, or you, you know, did take out a lot. And if you stop that for just a short amount of time, you might realize, you know, I don't really value that. I don't really miss it as much as I thought I would. And then going forward, you might be able to spend less there.
We just started promoting a new challenge called the 34-day reset. Anyone out there doing the 34-day reset? The cool thing about this challenge is kind of like if you guys have heard of 75 hard, you can start it any day. So just because you didn't start when we, you know, launched the challenge at the beginning of the month doesn't mean that you couldn't start it today, or maybe you take a few days to get ready for it. But we actually did this in October, and it just has three rules. It's no dining out. So you prepare all your own food. That's the first rule. Only spend money on essentials. So you get to decide what essential is, and track all of your spending. Very simple rules that resulted in us saving, I think, our grand total at the end was $1,700.
Wow, that's awesome. Yeah. And we found, we kind of did some pilot tests of this before we launched it. And we found that the average person saves about $1,000 in 34 days on this, which is crazy to me. Like, it seems like a huge amount of money. And of course, you know, some people are less and some people are more, like you, Kelly. But yeah, it can make a big difference and really change your mindset.
What could you do with an extra $1,000 in 1 month? Like, that's,
think about that.
And that's, on average, you're looking to find $34 a day is what we're prompting. Yeah. But look, doing it. Teresa's on day 6. Oh, my God.
Love it.
Close to 800 already, almost done. I know a bunch of you you're rounding the corner. This is the last week of our big group that was doing it. If you go to that website that Ben dropped in the comments, you can actually join our 34-day reset Facebook community too, which is pretty fun.
Yeah, you'll get an email with the link there. Yeah, close to $800 for Mejaflek. So that's pretty cool. Love it. Love it.
And someone can't see comments. We're broadcasting to a bunch of different places right now. We're online.
Oh, yeah.
On Twitch and also on our YouTube channel too. So that might be where some of those comments.
I see Livlin, you're on Twitch. So actually, I think you might be one of our two viewers on Twitch over there. So hey, thank you. Actually, you might be our only one, actually, because I think that I'm the other viewer. So there you go. So thank you for watching on Twitch.
But now YouTube knows that we're on Twitch too.
Yeah, join our Twitch. It's awesome. I'll get you a link. I'm gonna
sometimes Ben and I play budgeting games on Twitch.
Yeah, we want to do more there, so you know, we're figuring it out. So yeah, definitely check that out. So why don't we move on now to the biggest place people save money?
The most notoriously overspent category.
Groceries.
Our saving money on groceries workshop. We go over a lot of tips on that one, but we can run through a few of them here too.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah, and this is why, you know, eating out was one of the things on our 34-day reset, one of the rules, because everyone, I mean, like, almost without exception, everybody, when they start budgeting, says, oh, I can't believe how much I spend on eating out. And that's one of the biggest places they cut. So yeah, I think, but also when it comes to groceries, you can save money too. So
yeah. Starting right out, not going to the grocery store hungry has been a game changer when it comes to me saving money on groceries. And that's just because I'm much more likely to buy impulse purchases when I'm there, which usually aren't the healthiest options for me, but they also don't fit in with my, my meal plan.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I remember I went through a period where every time I went to the grocery store, you know, the little candies or snacks that are right there at the aisle. I know, right? I wasn't so much worried about the money, because I had some personal spending for that. But I was worried about the health thing, because every time I go to the store, I grab a candy or something. And so I stopped. I said, I'm not going to do this. And I remember I was addicted to it. It was you know, like a response to like stimulus. Like I was, I was there and I was not doing it. And I felt like I was getting hungry and yeah, it's
oh, I'm sure you're not alone there. There's psychology behind what goes yes. into that. And you know, I think another way that I've learned that I've saved money, and this goes against what our plan over here is, but when I learn that there is like a psychological response for me to do something and it almost feels like I'm being manipulated yeah. and I rebel against that.
That is your personality, Kelly, for sure. Well, once I realized that
you don't tell me what I'm gonna get when I'm checking out. I'm going back to the aisle to get those chips.
So that marketing is the opposite effect on Kelly here. But seriously, like it, yeah, and that's another reason why it's good to do maybe a spending freeze, because you might realize you have an emotional reaction to choosing not to do something, and you kind of might realize, oh, I'm conditioned to do this behavior. And once you realize that, you can start working against it. So
totally.
That's huge. Yeah.
Back on track.
Another thing is just, yeah. Another thing is just buy fewer things if you can. Try to like rotate your snacks, I think is a good idea. So you have some variety, but you're not buying like a whole lot of different stuff and it's some of it going bad and all that.
Yeah, I follow this family on YouTube that has 10 children. And so each month there's a snack of the month. It's usually a snack that's on sale and they buy enough for all of them for the whole month. And then the next month they pick a different snack. So that's kind of cool.
There you go. Yeah, and store brands is huge. I mean, sometimes the quality is, there is a difference, but a lot of times it's the same thing. Like it's really the same thing.
The same place. Like the mustard, yellow mustard, the bottle looks the same because it's made in the same place and filled with the same stuff. It just has a different
label on it. Yeah. It's seriously, you can literally check the ingredients and you can tell sometimes, oh, this is actually just the same thing. So yeah, you might try that. You mentioned shopping on a full belly. It's huge.
Farmers markets. If you are in a place that has them right now, you're a lucky person. That's yes, colder. Yeah. I am in northern Wisconsin, but even just buying something that's made locally usually saves you money as well, because there's more of it. It doesn't have to travel as far, and so it ends up costing less. And then buying in bulk whenever possible is also really a great way to spend money, because if you buy chicken at a sale price, you're always eating it at that sale price, no matter how long it lasts, right? Mm-hmm. But there's a balance there. You want to make sure you have storage space for those bulk purchases. And I actually budget for bulk food separately from my regular groceries, so I can take advantage of those sales when they pop up.
Yeah. Another, probably one of my favorite tips that we share in the Saving Money on Groceries workshop is having some emergency meals available. And this is to avoid eating out, because you know we're going to talk about meal planning a lot here in a minute, but you can make the best plan ever, but then, you know, things happen. You have a bad day at work, or, you know, kids are crazy, or, you know, you're just not feeling well and you don't want to cook. Right. And so this is where a lot of people could take out that was unplanned and bust the budget there. So if you have some emergency meals handy, these are things that maybe you can prep ahead of time and put in the freezer. You don't have to cook it because it's already prepped, and it can make things a lot easier. So rules on that. It should be easy. It's got to be easier than takeout even, right? It should be something that you look forward to a lot. Like maybe it's like a frozen pizza. I don't know, like whatever it is for you. And it has to beat the cost of takeout. So those are the three things to consider
there. Yeah. And like this could be frozen pizza. It could be, I like to batch cook chili and then I have frozen jars of it in the freezer.
Any kind of soup is good, right?
Yeah. Yeah. Now, yeah. A couple people are asking what the name of that family I follow is on YouTube. They're called Our Tribe of Many. Our Tribe of Many.
I'll type that out for everybody. Our Tribe of Many on YouTube. There you go. All right. So I think that does it for just the spend less. Let's get a little more specific on you know, meal planning and things like that. So yeah, let's talk about planning ahead of time for your grocery shopping. So just like with budgeting, you know, where we look at the information we have now and we plan ahead for how we're going to spend money, plan ahead for how you're going to, what you're going to eat. And usually what most people do is plan for the next week. And you don't necessarily have to plan every single meal, like breakfast, lunch, and dinner, because a lot of those things can kind of be the same every day or most of the time. But plan dinners especially. What are you going to make for your family for dinner? And if you plan that out ahead of time, not only will it help you save money because it's going to reduce a lot of waste and it's going to reduce a lot of the, just the impulse buying and things like that, but it's also going to bring a lot of peace of mind, because when you are, I mean, there's nothing worse than coming home from a long day and everybody saying, what's for dinner? And you have no idea. Right.
That's stressful. Seeing through the takeout line, the same way that the emergency meal does. And I think I rebel a little bit against planning as well, in that I don't like to plan a specific meal for a specific day, but rather I'll plan and get the items I need for like three dinners throughout the week.
Nice.
Yeah. I know we're going to have leftovers on one day, and maybe we do plan for takeout one night.
Right.
But that doesn't mean you're not planning. Your plan can represent the things that matter to you, and being able to be slightly impulsive matters to me.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's good. Yeah, and sometimes we'll even plan specific days, but then we're like, you know what? We're gonna do takeout today, and we'll do one of our planned meals another day, and then you can do that too. As long as you work out, like, don't want to eat that food to go bad too.
Like Taco Tuesday.
Yes, love that. Or like Pizza Friday, like,
Yeah. And like Monday for us, we usually cook a roast a thing, like a chicken, right? And then whatever's left over from Monday, the protein, we just shove it into a taco on Tuesday, because anything can be a taco, right?
That's a great idea. Yeah, we do leftovers on Mondays, but maybe we should do something like that on Mondays and then tacos. I'm very hungry. All right, so.
I think we're all hungry now, aren't we?
I think we're all very hungry now. So dedicated meal nights is really helpful because it reduces the cost, the mental cost of planning a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
But coupled with the planning is a shopping list, right? And so this requires you to kind of know what you have in the pantry. So shop your pantry too when you're making the plan, see what you already have. And what you don't have, you put on a list, and you only buy things that are on that list, right? And that's kind of the plan there.
Has anyone here ever been to the grocery store and only bought what was on their list? I've done it a few times.
I think I've done it a few times.
Well, you guys are so good at that, though. You've got the system down.
Well, my wife Caitlin is particularly good at it. I take no credit for it because she's in charge of the
grocery. Ben wrote an incredible blog post about how his family does their shopping meal planning, and it's very impressive. One day I want to be like Ben when I grow up.
I'll find that for you guys. We've gotten a little looser since I wrote that blog, but
it's been a year.
Yeah, it's been a year.
My kids are older. We all should be flexible with ourselves over this past year.
I dropped a link for that blog if you want to check out how my family does it. We go into lots of detail on how we plan and stuff like that there. So, yeah, and lots of folks talking about how shopping online really helps. I discovered that this year because, we didn't want to go into the store, and all these grocery stores are offering curbside pickup now, which is like awesome when you have three little kids too. So, we've been almost always doing that now, and it helps tremendously because you can just shop from the list, and you're not like seeing the random thing you want to buy because you're not walking through the grocery store. So
that can be huge. And you get in and out of there so much faster, and you don't stray, and you know you got everything you needed. It's so convenient. And there are tons of services you can use to make this easier for yourself. So we're gonna rattle off a few, but we have a handout that actually has all of these, most of them listed. And is the link to that in the description?
Link to that is in the description. There's a handout with a few cool apps there. We'll mention a few more too.
Is there a way
I'm just gonna take that away there. No, I think that's all we got there.
Flip is one that you can download onto your phone. And the cool thing is it gives you the circular for the stores in your area, so you know what's on sale this week. Paprika, I'm going to steal this one too, Ben, because I really like this one.
Paprika, this is what we use. We use Paprika.
I use Paprika. Nice. It's so great. You know when you're reading a blog post and the lady is talking about how like it's her grandmother's rolling pin and it's been in her family, and you're like, okay, but like how much cream do I need to add because it's boiling, so I love Paprika because it, when you drop a recipe into it, it removes all of those extra words, just gives you the ingredients and the directions.
It's like criminal sometimes. These blog posts are so long, and they're just doing it so it shows up on Google better and stuff. It's like, just give me the recipe, guys.
Yeah,
come on.
And then what you can do is you can make a shopping list from the recipes that you drop into your meal plan calendar, and then you can check them off. You can text them to your partner if they're going to the store, the shopping
Pretty
list.
Cool. Pretty cool.
I'm a big paprika fan. I mean, but there's one that's like it too.
An inventory. You can keep an inventory of your pantry in there too. I don't use that part. But I have. Yeah, that's a little.
That's
much.
Level three.
That's the next level.
I'm a solid level two person when it comes to life.
yeah. But I have seen that there. I was like, oh, that's kind of cool. Meal Lime is another one. It'll create it's like a personalized meal planning. Service based on the number of people that you have, any dietary restrictions you have, and it'll create a shopping list for you too. So that's a cool one. Mm-hmm. Oh, this is a new one that you listed here, Kelly.
Oh, Skinny Taste. It's a great recipe resource website. You get ideas for all kinds of delicious food there, and it's your classic dishes with a healthy twist, which I really like. So it gives you like the low calorie version of General Tso's chicken or how to make a pot pie without two sticks of butter. I've been enjoying that one a lot this year.
I mean, is it even worth it without two sticks of butter? No, I'm sure it is.
Maybe
I'm
just
sure it's fine. I just want it. And then there's so many great things out there. Reddit has a few great subreddits. There's one called Eat Cheap and Healthy with just lots of cheap and healthy recipes and people talking about it. So you know what's good because you know, Reddit always upvotes the best stuff. So you'll know what's actually good. Also, Meal Prep Sunday on Reddit that's really cool, where people not only do they plan their meals for the week, but they also prep their meals for the week. And you don't necessarily have to cook it, but you can like prep a lasagna or something, you know, and put it in the refrigerator.
You chop up your onions and then you use them on Mondays and Wednesdays for both meals. And you've already done
it. Take all that work and put it all at once on a Sunday or whatever.
It's like you're making your own meal box.
Yeah. Yeah. It is like that.
Did we just invent something?
I mean, I guess. I think the meal box people did, but.
But we invented
you can mail it to yourself, just like, you know, like prep a meal. Here it is, guys. If you want a mailbox, here's a free way to do mailbox. Prep a meal, do it all yourself, and then put it in the mail and mail it to yourself. And when it arrives, you'll have your food.
Not to put down those meal boxes, though. Those things are so convenient. I've tried all of them.
I got the
free trial for every single one. Yeah, but Blue Apron, HelloFresh. There's one called something in the fig. I've done them all, and I really enjoyed them. And if that is the way that you can get yourself on board with cooking at home and stop yourself from going out to eat every meal, I think that that's a great thing to try.
Nice. Yeah, whatever you can do. Whatever
Definitely.
Helps.
We've talked a lot about food, Ben. We might need to move on soon.
Yeah, we should probably move on. We talked an awful lot about food. I mean, we can go as long as we want, I guess.
There's some great tips in here. Let's cruise through those, and then we'll move on to the other stuff. And we can always circle back.
Sure. Let's do that. So, stock up on sales when you can't. Oh, you're talking about the comments. Let's talk about comments. Yeah.
This is great. I plan meat weekly, and You've got your emergency meal ready to go with your spaghetti and your meatballs. Great tip, Heather.
That's awesome. Yeah, love it. This person says, I get groceries for 2 weeks. I plan the amount of protein I need, veggies, and some other stuff. It's very easy. Yeah, actually, we just started doing this. Actually, we started recently buying everything for an entire month. Like, we did 2 weeks for a while, and then we did a month. And it's really nice. It's a lot of work up front. And it's not like we buy literally everything. Like, we still need to buy like fresh produce and stuff.
Yeah, throughout the
week. Once a week, you know, but most of the vast majority of stuff, we do like one big grocery pickup, and it's pretty awesome. Actually, we have a blog about that.
Yeah, Chrissy wrote a blog. She's got 4 or 5 children at home. And they shop for the entire month, and then they go once a week to get their basics. The family I follow on YouTube does that as well. And they're shopping for 12 people for an entire month.
Yeah, that's serious business.
Dan asked a good question here. What are the most common time frames for planning food? This is exactly what we're talking about. I think the tricky thing, the longer your time frame is, that's when you get into the weeds of like things could go bad from the time you purchase them to the time you use them. So you need to strategically plan your meals so that you're eating the freshest stuff first.
Yeah, like what can you freeze and what do you not want to freeze and all that? So if you're doing biweekly or monthly, then you are going to have to also plan for maybe a weekly trip for fresh produce and stuff. So,
or you can use frozen and canned and like there are people that live in the middle of there that aren't going to the grocery store every week. You know, like they survive really. They figured it out, so it's possible. You might not get your, you know, your special yogurt that, you know, I don't know, whatever. But that's important to you. And that's what you should get.
Yeah.
So cool. You guys are sharing some fun tips over there.
Yeah. Let's see if there's anything else.
A question about the link to the challenge. Is the link also in our description, Ben?
Yeah, it should be in the description. Let me double check that. I put it in there just for, yeah, it's in there. So yeah. Cool. And it's just wineapp.com/34day reset, all one word, 34 day reset. And that'll come up for you.
Very cool. So maybe we switch gears now and we start talking about saving money on other things.
Yes. Yeah, it's not all about food, right? So
it is lunchtime though. So maybe that's why we were so excited to talk about food.
I mean, I'll talk about food all day. I mean, there's so much there to discuss, but yeah, let's talk about some other stuff too. Just saving money on bills. First, I think the low-hanging fruit is subscriptions, because we, I think a lot of us in these days have a lot of those. So like ask yourself, you know, it's really funny. When we first wrote this tip, we said, do you really need Hulu, Netflix, and Amazon Prime, right? But now I think we need to say, do you really need Hulu, Netflix, and Amazon Prime, and Disney Plus, CBS All Access and Peacock, and you know, it's everybody's every company in the world is jumping on this train now. So do you need all of them? I mean, maybe if you're trying to cut back, think about what you're using and what maybe you're not using. And you could even just pause the subscriptions, like maybe turn it off. Actually, here's a tip. I use a website called justwatch.tv. And it's pretty cool because you can like search a show or a movie and it'll tell you what service it's on.
Oh, that's cool.
In one place. Yeah. And it's been pretty reliable for me. And that's kind of neat because maybe you really want to watch a certain show, but you're not sure what service it's on. Mm-hmm. And if you're like me, you only watch one show at a time. So maybe you can even pause subscriptions on wherever you're not watching and turn them on later, you know?
Yeah. Just like the food boxes that I subscribed for all of them. I took advantage of all the free trials of all the TV network individual streaming services. But what I did was I set a reminder in my calendar to cancel them the day before the free trial expired. And so that way I wouldn't get charged for them unless I was watching something on that particular network, in which case I would let it ride for a month and enjoy the show.
Yeah, that's a good idea. Just like set a reminder, even if it's not the trial, like set a reminder once a month and be like,
review
it. Yeah. Yeah. And maybe I'm not, cause there's times where you watch a lot of Netflix and there's times where you might watch a lot of Hulu, you know? And so you might switch them out every once in a while.
Yeah.
Instead of doing them all at once. And there's bundle deals too out there for sure. So we're basically getting cable again, I think, you know, So check this out.
Weird time. Utilities are another place that you can cut back from pretty easily. Obviously, you can't change how much your electric bill is this month, but you could start looking at things to cut back from it for next month, right? Whether it's changing the temperature on your water heater, making it a little bit cooler, or analyzing the bills you're already paying. Like, do you need the highest speed internet? Are you still all streaming from home, or have some of you gone back to school or work? And so you could adjust that speed, you know, just reassessing your life. In the phone, if you are all home, do you really need the unlimited data plan on your phone, or could you get by with less? And that could save you a lot in the long run.
Yeah. I just realized I sent the wrong the wrong URL. It's not just watch TV. It's justwatch.com now. So I think it used to be that.
Just but, watch TV is a way better.
I know, right? Yeah, I guess they wanted to be all legitimate and be a .com. You know, so there you go. But yeah, check that out. Check that out.
All right. Let's talk about cars.
Yes, let's talk about cars. One thing, this is near and dear to my family because we went through this. You could ask yourself, do you really need two cars? Now, I don't know about most, but a lot of families do need two cars because you got people going in different directions. But I went through this. We had two cars. We had, you know, I had the dad van and a little 1995 Toyota Camry, which I loved. We couldn't drive it very far because it would catch on fire possibly.
Yeah.
But I'm not joking. Like actually it had like oil leak and yeah, anyways. So, you know, it was good to sputter around town a little bit. And a while back that car died. I took it in for a state inspection and it was not worth fixing. So we got rid of that and started saving for a new car. And it took us, you know, we wanted to buy in cash. And so it was going to take us a while to save a used car. And we're like, well, we could use just the van for a while. And it took us so long to save for it, like 10 months we were saving for it. And after a while we were like, you know, we're doing fine with just one car. My wife and I both work from home. Our kids are not in that many activities because they're pretty young right now. So for now, it's fine for us. There's a few times where it's inconvenient, you know, but most of the time it's not a big deal. So
like when the one car needs to be fixed.
Yes. That is, well, now I found a mechanic who gives me a loaner now. So it's like golden.
But, he swaps cars with you.
Yeah, basically. So, you know.
And yeah. I kind of have an opposite story. We had a car in the shop and I started questioning, do we really need two cars? And I didn't have access to my car for almost 2 weeks. And I was going crazy at the end of those 2 weeks. And so it wasn't an option for our family. And so I think just give it a try, acknowledge what your priorities are, and then make a decision that's right for you, because there's definitely not one answer for everyone for anything. In that matter.
Yeah. Or maybe it's not like, maybe you have more than two cars and you're like, do we really need that truck? You know, maybe you have like some cars that are sweating around and you also have a truck around, you know, how many times do you use it? You know, ask yourself questions like that. So those are the big questions to ask, you know, do you need more than one car? Do you need different cars? You know, but there's also, I mean, there's so many things around cars too, like insurance rates, try to shop those a little bit. Mm-hmm. Maybe if you've been budgeting for a while and you've been saving for anything that could go wrong with a car, maybe you could opt for a higher deductible if you can afford that. If you got those true expenses going, that can save you a ton of money
or if your car is 15 years old, do you need collision insurance?
Right. I mean, I'll tell you, we did not have collision on our 1995 Toyota Camry because it was worth like $300. Like I can handle losing $300, it's okay, you know.
So. We paid off our car a few years ago, and I realized like a year later that we still had collision because it was a requirement when we were still paying it off to the credit union. That was like a lien requirement, and so we were able to remove that because it wasn't worth very much, and it was paid off and it was ours, and we could so just reassess what you got and see if it's still what you need.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And then shopping around when your car is broken can save you a ton of money. I'm actually, it's the same car, same problem we're having again. cars, blah, blah, blah. But I shopped around. We found a mechanic, a local small mechanic that it looks like has figured out what the problem is. And so, and his rate is significantly lower than the dealership's was. So just shopping around before you get the car fixed and being clear when you bring it in that, you know, I'd like to know what the estimate's going to be before we do any repairs. There's nothing wrong with that. And also anyone that gives you a hard time when you say, I need a little bit of time to think about that, or I want to talk to my partner about that first. Like
that's huge.
That's a red flag. So like, you know,
if you feel like you need to take a shower after talking to a mechanic, like, you know, get out of there.
Right. Yeah, or anyone for that matter.
Or anybody. Yeah. Any kind of professional for that matter. But you know, and then on the other hand, like I found a mechanic that I feel like I can really trust. Mm-hmm. And because he's a good mechanic and people can trust him, he can charge higher prices because of that. So, you know, you got to think about that too. Like, if you find somebody that you can really trust and is good at their job, then it might be worth paying a little extra for it too.
Yeah. Hard work is worth a lot of money. Like,
yeah.
And trust.
And trust.
And trust in them is it's hard to put a price on that.
Yeah. Robbie asked, buy new or used? I mean, this is the age old question, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, I don't think I'm ever going to buy a new car. I feel like even if I'm a millionaire, I'm not sure I'm ever going to do it because you just lose so much right off the bat. And even if you want an almost new car, if you get like a 2-year-old car, a huge amount of the depreciation happens within 2 years. Mm-hmm. So you can still get a nice car, but maybe a couple years old, it could make a big difference. But you know, I'm not going to tell you can't have a new car if you want.
Right. No, some people, cars are their passion. Like that's what they love in their life. Totally. Like, tell them that they can't have a new car. Like, why not? Like it's what they really, really want. I mean, I don't really care about my car. I would like,
right. Me neither.
I live in Northern Wisconsin. Everyone, we're going to preface, but one day I would like a heated steering wheel. That's
that is not something I think about at all in Virginia, but I can imagine.
When you get in the car and you don't have your gloves on and you touch and it hurts. Like I've done this so many times to drive because my hands
are so cold. I had the opposite problem because I grew up in Dallas, Texas, and it would be like boiling hot.
Belt buckle touch you because it's gonna burn.
It was seriously would like scorch you, and the steering wheel would do that too. It was we need like a steering wheel cooler, but it's a thing, guys. What I really want is a car that has like a Bluetooth speaker that system that connects to my phone, because I got a rental once and it had that and it was totally spoiled me. So.
It's hard to get a
car. I guess I could put that into my 2005 van if I wanted to, but we'll see maybe one day.
One day. It's good to dream and look forward to these things.
I mean, that'd be pretty awesome to have like this van with like this souped out. I should just do like Pimp My Ride, basically have like a hot tub in the back, like all that. Or not, whatever. All right, so saving money around the house.
It's hard. You can't go far these days without finding a website to sell stuff on. I feel like they pop up on my feeds all the time. There's like Mercari, there's Craigslist, there's Facebook Marketplace.
The competition there is huge. Right. There's a lot of stuff to help.
Look around. Yeah. What aren't you using that's worth something? Because it could be worth something to someone else. And
Just take a legal pad and walk around your house and write down stuff that you could sell. Mm-hmm. You might not necessarily want to sell it. You might decide not to, but just write down stuff that maybe you could get rid of. And you might have a big, long list. And especially if you're trying to do something, like maybe you're trying to pay off debt and you kind of have like a cash flow squeeze right now. If you could sell a bunch of stuff and knock out one of those smaller debts and get that cash flow back, that could get the ball rolling for you, So going through a period where you just maybe have a garage sale or go crazy and sell stuff online, it could really help.
And then also, like, instead of buying something new, maybe you look on those same places to find that thing used or borrow it from someone or rent it. They have a lot of like small towns now, or even big towns have like tool libraries that you can go to because how often do you need that very specific tool, like miter saw or whatever it is? Example, but what I mean. And see if you can rent it or borrow it before you commit to buying that. I did that with a juicer. I had a friend loan me a juicer for a couple weeks. I returned it with a big bag of vegetables as a thank you and decided I didn't need a juicer because saving the price of a juicer. It was great.
That's awesome. Yeah. And then of course the biggest thing is possibly downsizing if you really want to, especially if you have a really big goal. Some people get themselves in a situation where it's like, I have too much house and I'm like house poor, So, and ask yourself, do I have more than I need? Are you using your entire house? Or maybe you could cut back a little bit. And it doesn't just cost, we're not just talking about the rent or the mortgage, but also taxes or heating and cooling, all the utilities. You can save a lot more than maybe even you think.
Yeah. Or where you're living.
Yeah.
So many of us now these days are fortunate enough to be able to work from our homes. Do we have to stay in the same city that we were in? Is there a reason why we're there? Those are the kind of questions you can ask yourself.
Yeah, we have a lot of discussions about that because, at YNAB, we're remote, so we're all over the country. And everybody's jealous of me because housing is super cheap here, and everybody who lives in California and Washington are like shooting daggers at me over here, right? So, it makes a big difference if you can move or, you want to. That can really make a difference.
But it's also weighing the value. Like for some people, California is where their family is, or it's where they feel the most at home. And so that's the place that you should be,
And you pay a cost for that, and it's might be totally worth it, So there's all these are all things to consider.
And really, it comes back to deciding, like, why is it you're looking to cut back, right? We should have a reason why we're trying to spend less, whether it's to pay down debt, to build up your savings, to accomplish some dream that you have for your life. Like that should be at the finish line, and you're looking at that goal every time you make one of those decisions. And that can make such a difference in your mindset when it comes to, like, do I really need this thing? But if I sell this thing, it gets me closer to that goal, which is far more important to me. Like I'm sitting here with this. This is a used iPhone. It was just sitting on if this was something that could get me closer to a really important savings goal, this would be something I would consider selling, And so that's the kind of stuff you start thinking about when you're focusing on that why.
Yeah, that's good. Something we say around here a lot that I really love is it's not about spending less. It's about spending right. And I think that really makes the difference. It's about making sure your money is going to the places that you want it to go and not to the stuff you don't care about. Right. So that's a good mindset to have. But also, if cutting something is just going to make you more stressed, like financially or even just emotionally, that's probably not a good place to start too, right? So, be careful here. Check your spirit when you're just making these decisions and listen to your heart there, I think. If you feel like it's going to make a big difference, you might end up making the choice to let go of that thing or to cut back there, but maybe don't start there, I would say.
Yeah. So. And, but this, all of these tips we've given you guys, most of them you can apply to budgeting itself. Like the theory behind YNAB is that we want to feel in control of our money. We want to feel in control of our lives. And by acknowledging what your priorities are, it allows you to do that. It allows you to feel that control. So trust your gut for sure.
Yeah.
A couple of questions.
Sultan asked to name the app for grocery shopping. There is a link in the description for a handout, and it has a few of the things we mentioned there. The ones we like the most as far as shopping.
And I think the ones we mentioned were Paprika was the big one we talked about. That might be what you're referring to, Sultan.
Yeah, that's probably what you're referring to. That's one we both like a lot.
Yeah.
Well said, Heather. I love that.
Because so many people think budgeting means you should spend as little money as possible, when really it should be you spend money on the things that matter most.
Yeah, I love it. I like this. This is interesting. Dave said, I have a friend who purchased an electric car, and he said the cost is almost zero. As well, rebates, green incentives. Yeah, I mean, if you live in a place like California or a place where they're really pushing for electric vehicles, look into what you can. You might be able to get some subsidies or something. So if you can only go 90 miles on a charge.
Right, but there's all kinds of other costs that, like, having a charging station in your house is super expensive. And just things to consider. I don't even know, like, where do you take a electric car to get fixed? Can you just take it to a regular dealership? How much does it cost to insure?
Those are things to consider for sure. Yeah, Dave said you can only drive 90 miles on a charge. But, maybe this car is, if you can do it cheaper, is just to get around town. And then if you want to go on a longer trip, you could rent a car, and it might still be cheaper. So that's something to consider. I think a lot of people get into, I like to go on a trip every a couple times a year, so I need a car that, can reliably go 200 miles. And it's like, you could go with an older car to get around town. And then if you are going on a trip, you could rent something and you almost certainly would save more than buying a new car, So that's something to consider.
There's a question from much earlier that I wanted to circle back to from Craig. if you're trying to save more, would you suggest immediately adjusting those goals or just reduce the spending and let the difference roll over while you're, when you're confident about it? Figuring out like how much do I actually spend on stuff. When you're first getting started budgeting, you probably don't even know how much you spend on groceries, let alone how much extra you can put toward your debt or your other savings goals. So I would say, first step is to guess.
Yes, that's what we always say. Give it your best guess. Just try. Just try something.
You'll learn really quickly if your guess is super wrong, right? And that right there, that is a learning opportunity that you can take, move forward to next month, and you guess again, and I bet you're going to be closer this time. And so once you have been budgeting for a few months, you'll start to see those trends. But the other thing that happens when you're budgeting is you become a lot more aware of what you do spend money on. And if you check your budget before you spend, you'll see if what you're about to buy is in line with the priorities you have, if it's going to cause overspending in your budget. And if that's the case, where do you plan on covering that overspending from? And those little pieces of information can completely change the way you think about spending that money. You might decide you don't want that thing, or you might decide to cover it from somewhere else, and you immediately know what priority has shifted because of that purchase.
Totally. I love it. Yeah, that's well said.
You'll learn quickly, Craig.
Yeah, any other questions we need to talk about? Yep. Should we write our song, Kelly?
Oh, gosh, yes. We're going to need a song.
All right. So I have prepared nothing as far as the song goes, but we're gonna write this thing together. Although I prepared a little bit because I've been playing a little Champagne Problems by, our friend Taylor here. So I think we could maybe do some budgetified lyrics for that. I'm
sure that they all guessed that you were going to sing a Taylor Swift song.
Of course. I mean, come on. And this song is like, it's my jam. It's a little sad, you know, it's a little bit of a bummer. It's a minor key, but you know, I think we can do it. All right. So let's bring it down a little bit. All right.
Heather, I just put the link to the handout in the chat one more time for everyone.
Handout's in the chat. All right. Trying to save some money. Isn't it funny how hard it can be? Saving money on groceries. There are some apps that can make it easier. Like maybe paprika, baby, meal lime or something. I don't know. There's probably something else.
To-do-ist.
Or maybe you want to save money on cars. You could buy a used one instead. If you want to find a good mechanic, that might be cheaper and not so expensive. Let's skip to what's your why here. But don't forget to ask yourself, what's your reason you're doing all this cutting spending? What's your reason? She goes low there, Taylor. Man, It's not about spending less now. It's about spending right. Think about your priorities and live the life you want. All right, I'm done. I think that's about all we got here. Made it
out. I'm applauding for all 111 people that are here, Ben.
Woo, that was
fantastic.
A little rough.
I'm surprised they haven't called you for your record deal yet, because I would listen to that song.
I don't know. I think Taylor pulls off that low note a little better than I do, but you know, it's cool.
Here they all come.
Yeah, all right.
Oh, is this a YNAB lampshade? It is a sticker on a lamp. But I'm so afraid.
You can't commit. You can't make that kind of a commitment.
Yeah. I cannot commit stick. So it just hangs out. Here.
Yeah, that's a big commitment there. Oh, yeah. There's YNAB swag everywhere. Yeah, for sure. All right. Well, I think we'll go ahead and wrap it up here, guys. If you're new to YNAB and you'd like to check out our app or any of our free resources, we've got tons of stuff to teach you how to cut money, cut spending and budget. Check out our website, YNAB.com. That's YNAB.com. And links in the description if you want to go in there. Other thing I wanted to mention, next week we are starting up again our YNAB Get Started Bootcamp. That is a Facebook group where if you're new to YNAB and new to the software, you can go and get some really good instruction from Dave, who is one of our teachers. And he'll be going live every day next week. Fantastic. In that group. So if you're interested in joining, there's a link in the description for that as well. And that's a good way to learn YNAB if you're new. So check that out. Yeah,
spending challenge, 34-day challenge. You find that in the description too.
Yeah, yeah. And also, I should mention, if you want more of this kind of thing, check out our workshops as well. We have live instruction is like really at the heart of what we do. So if you want to join some other workshops on using the app or more general ones, like how to create a debt plan or how to save money on groceries, check out YNAB.com/workshops. They're every day. They're short, 20 minutes.
Free. And
they're
free. 20 minutes.
Free, totally free.
Yep. So you might see one of us there.
That's true. We teach workshops, so you might see us when you jump in.
Awesome.
All right. Well, happy budgeting, everybody.
Happy budgeting. Thanks, everybody.
We'll see y'all later.